Okay, let's start talking about how to put all three of these together, the aperture, the shutter speed, and the ISO. It's really important to know where to find those on your camera. Hopefully you've watched the other videos that I have provided where I show you what the camera looks like and where to see these things and all the different buttons on your camera. That is in week 2 of the module as well, getting to know your camera. So the LCD screen can look different depending on which camera you have. Now, that's the hard part about an online photography course, is because you all, you know, half of you will have Canons, the other 5 will have Nikons, and there will be a couple of us who have like an Olympus or maybe a Sony brand, maybe a mirrorless camera, and your buttons are all in different places. So it's really important, as I say in Canvas, to familiarize yourself with your manual, to at least know, once you understand some of the vocabulary of photography, you'll be able to identify the buttons on the back of your camera. Also, be sure to do a Google search for your camera, the style, the brand, and I'm sure there are videos already online on YouTube or from the brand's website that'll go over some of these details of the camera buttons and camera functions with you. Exposure settings could look like this. So on the Canon, on this particular Canon, the shutter speed is right here, indicated by the 30 and these little hash mark, which is actually means 30 seconds. And then we have the F 5.6, so we know that's the f-stop, right? It's got the F right there. And you have your ISO of 200. All of these other features are other functions of the camera, so you would hit one of the other buttons on your camera in order to move around and choose these other functions, which we will talk about during the semester. On this camera, it is a little bit different. They're all sort of in a row here. Here we have the shutter speed again, 1/4000th of a second. Notice that this is different shutter speed than the common shutter speeds I've already talked with you about, but 1000 doubles to 2000 and 2000 doubles to 4000, so it still follows as one of the common shutter speeds that your camera could have. And there's the F4. And we see ISO 100. Now inside the viewfinder, that's really important because most of this semester and most of the time that you are taking pictures, you will have the viewfinder pressed up to one of your eyes so that you are looking through the viewfinder while you are taking photographs. And you're never really pulling the camera away to look at the back of the screen unless you need to change something in the menu or something like that. But if you have your camera set up and you're ready to photograph, you know, kids playing soccer or having a picnic with your family outside, then you basically set up your ISO. Then you just need to know where the buttons are on your camera to change your f-stop and your shutter speed in order to get a good exposure. And you can do that while looking through the viewfinder. So notice that right here, this is the shutter speed, but it doesn't show you a fraction. So in the viewfinder, the shutter speed is not a fraction. It's just the bottom number. And then you have your f-stop. Again, the letter F is not anywhere to be seen, but this one is your f-stop, and it should always be in this order. If yours is different, please take note as to which one comes first, the shutter speed or the f-stop. And then you have what is very important. This is your lifeline. This little guide right here is your lifeline to taking a good exposure. It is called your light meter. This is the light meter indicator that tells you if you have a good exposure or not. And when that little check mark or little marker, this little rectangle, it indicates underneath the middle, and sometimes that middle looks like a circle, it could be a triangle, it could be another rectangle, then you have a good exposure. Let's look at some bad exposures. Well, we have at least one good exposure here, but the other two are not good exposures. This is an example of changing only one thing about your settings. So let's say we start with this image here, exposure F10 at 1/60 at ISO 1600, okay? This is a good exposure. I'm gonna say when this was taken, the light meter indicated in the middle. And that makes sense. It looks like a good exposure. It's not too bright, it's not too dark. But let's say, you know what? I really wanted to get all of those quarters in focus. I want to get all those quarters in focus, so I need to change my f-stop to f22. So I'm gonna do that. But then I take the picture. Look what happens. First of all, it doesn't get all the quarters in focus. That would be changing of depth of field. See the difference? It gets the first quarter in focus and a little bit of the second quarter, but not quite the back one. That's for a lot of reasons. One reason is because I'm zoomed in, and another reason is because I'm very close to the subject, the quarter. And we'll talk about all of the things that affect depth of field a little later this semester. But that is what's happening. Another thing that's happening is that I'm way underexposed. This is very, very dark. There's no way that light meter right here was indicating in the middle when that photograph was taken. It was definitely on the minus side and most likely blinking on the minus side. Okay, so let's go back to the good exposure. And now let's say I took this exposure and said, you know what, I like it, but I want the depth of field to be even shallower. So I want to open up my f-stop to f4. Exposure f4, same shutter speed, same ISO. That's not going to work either because I've let more light in with my f-stop. My f-stop got wider. It's letting more light in. Yeah, it's giving me shallower depth of field. Look at that. It's just a sliver of the front of the quarter is in focus, but my exposure is much too bright. Definitely, it is now blinking on the right side, okay? On the plus side, I should say. Okay, now for this example, we are only changing the shutter speed. And so that's really important to recognize. Notice that the f-stop is staying stable, f-stop 8 in all three of these picture examples. And so my depth of field in these images is not changing at all. The depth of field stays the same because the f-stop is not changing and the shutter speed is changing. And so if this object were in motion, we would also see it from sharp to blurry, right? Because the shutter speed is getting is fast in this exposure and slow in this exposure. But this subject isn't moving. So let's take a look at what we have here. The first exposure is good. The light meter is indicating in the middle, and that's great. And then for some reason, whatever reason, something could be going through your mind that you want to change the shutter speed to make it faster. Maybe you're afraid that your breathing or hand holding the camera might make it blur or something because of camera shake. So you change your shutter speed to 1 over 200, but your exposure gets way too dark because you didn't consider your exposure. You didn't consider your light meter at all. And so it got too dark. And the same thing here, for some reason, you decide to slow down your shutter speed to 1 over 30th, but you leave your f-stop the same and the ISO the same. It's going to let in too much light. The shutter speed is slow now. It's letting in more light. And so you have a very overexposed image. So that proves to us that you have to change at least one other thing while you are creating equivalent exposures or taking pictures of, could be different things, but let's say in the same lighting situation, your lighting stays consistent. Maybe you took a picture of your cat and then a plant, okay? And those things were in the same light. And so the first exposure you took was at f22 at 1/8 of a second, and the ISO was at 1600. But as long as your lighting situation stays the same, you can alter the f-stop or the shutter speed or the ISO in order to sort of change how your picture looks, let's say with the depth of field changing, okay, as the examples are here. But in these examples, I'm not changing the ISO. The ISO is staying the same. But let's say my first image was at f22. I started at ISO 1600 at f22, and I paid attention to my light meter at this point. I set up my ISO first. I put that into the camera. And then I set my aperture, my f-stop, to f22. But I'm pointing my camera at my subject, and I'm taking a light reading. And the light reading is telling me that as I change my shutter speed gets into the middle of that light meter indicator at 1/8 of a second. I take the picture and these are my results. But let's say I actually want to use a shallower depth of field. So I could just change to F10 and keep the other two settings, right? But we know from experience that F10 is opening up, it's letting in more light. And if I kept these the same, then that means my picture is going to be too bright, right? So I have to change my shutter speed as well. I move to F10, and that gives me shallower depth of field. I pay attention to my light meter, and as I change my shutter speed, my light meter gets to the middle at 1/50th of a second. And now in the bottom image, I want even shallower depth of field, so I open up again to F4. And if I were to leave the shutter speed at 1/50th, I would overexpose my picture. So instead, I am changing my shutter speed until my light meter indicates in the middle. And for this one, it indicated in the middle at 1/250th of a second. Notice that the ISO is the same in all three images, but when the aperture changes from a small f-stop to a large f-stop, that the background becomes much softer and the depth of field changes. There is no motion blur, even with slow shutter speeds, because the subject is not moving. All of these are correct exposures.